Good morning. Good morning. I greet you all in the name of Jesus Christ our Lord and Merry Christmas. We welcome you here in person and online as we join together to praise God and give thanks that our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ loved us so much that he came and took on flesh and dwelled with us. So let us prepare our hearts to worship as we go to him in prayer. Let us pray. Jesus, God, what a sweet name. There's no other sweeter name on this earth than Jesus. There's no other name as powerful on this earth as well, God. God, we're told that at the name of Jesus, every knee shall bow and every tongue will confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. God, we come today to pause and remember that you love us so much that you literally moved heaven and earth and moved the universe for each one of us here and each one of us at home and even our neighbor who may not know it, God, or may not recognize it. You moved heaven and earth and the universe. You took on this limited flesh. You came to be our hope, our joy, our peace, our love with skin on, God. So we come today to proclaim that your light shines in the darkness and the darkness isn't going to overcome it. Jesus, we come to declare your glory. And it's in your name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Would you please stand and join us now as we sing Joy to the World.
To the world, the Savior, the Oh.
morning comes from the Gospel of Luke, chapter 1, starting in verse 39. Mary got up and hurried to a city in the Judean highlands. She entered Zechariah's home and greeted Elizabeth. When Elizabeth heard Mary's greetings, the child leaped in her womb, and Elizabeth was filled with the Holy Spirit. With a loud voice, she blurted out, "God has blessed you above all women, and he has blessed the child you carry. Why do I have this honor that the mother of my Lord should come to me? As soon as I heard your greeting, the baby in my womb jumped for joy. Happy is she who believed that the Lord would fulfill the promises he made to her." Mary said, "With all my heart, I glorify the Lord. In the depths of who I am, I rejoice in God my Savior. He has looked with favor on the low status of his servant. Look, from now on, everyone will consider me highly favored, because the Mighty One has done great things for me. Holy is his name." This is the word of God for us, the people of God. Thanks be to God. You may be seated when the children's come for children's time.
It's Jesus' birthday, right? And so it's a surprise. It's knowing what's going to happen tomorrow morning, right? We know what's coming. So, but what if you knew what was coming? What if you knew what was coming was wrapped and waiting for you? Does it make it more exciting? So if you knew the gifts that you were fixing to get tomorrow, if you knew what was under the tree, would it be just as exciting? It's not. If you know what it is, it's not as exciting. So the surprise has gone away. Well, I think about it being more exciting. Has anybody ever had a Sour Patch Kid? It tastes sour, right? You've never had one?
I have, but they don't taste sour.
They don't taste sour, but I think they taste really, really sour. And it's just looking at it, I can taste it. My mouth starts to water, and I start to anticipate that sourness of that candy. With a warhead, yeah. You see it, and you start to think about it, right? And to me, it's more exciting to know that the gift, that I know what the gift is. And so, what if I told you that I've got a whole box of these over here, and that y'all get one of these? Now, does it make it more exciting? You start to think about it a little bit more, right? And so it's the same thing with Jesus' birth, right? Jesus has already came. He has already been born, he's already died, and he's already rose from the dead for us. And so, but the Israelites, they had to wait a long, long time. And even in the book of Isaiah, it says, for to us a child is born, to us a son is given, and the government shall be upon his shoulder, and his name shall be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. That was 700 years before Christ was born. So what if I told you, you can all have one of these, but you gotta wait 700 years? That changes it, right? They had to wait a really long time, but we don't have to wait for that, right? Jesus has already come. So how do you think each one of you can get wait for it, but then how are you going to get one? Be patient, be good. What else? How are you actually going to get one? I've got a whole bunch of them. Whole bunch of them. How do you get one? Huh? Be great? So you don't have to be good. You don't have to What you have to do is trust that I have the gift for you. And you got to ask for it. And so it's the same thing with Christ. It's the God's gift that he gave us, Jesus, we have to ask for it also. He has to, Jesus says, the knock and the door shall be open. Seek and you will find. Ask and you will receive. And God loves each and every one of you. This church loves each and every one of you. And so what I want you to do is to think about asking God for his gift. And what is his gift? What is the real gift of Christmas? Yeah?
What's the gift of Christmas?
Him, right? It's the fact not only that he was born and we're celebrating his birth, but it's that he came and he died and he is our salvation and he saved each and every one of us. But we have to ask for that gift, okay? That's right. Jesus is the reason for the season. And so I want us to think about asking Jesus for that gift. And so as you go through this Christmas season, think about that. So let's pray with me. Our Father in heaven, thank you for the gift of Jesus. Open our eyes, open our hearts, that we will seek and ask for Jesus. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. And what do y'all say to the congregation?
Good morning. Kind of like Shannon said last Sunday, when Leah texted me and asked me to give her a call, I naturally knew that she was going to ask me to do something for church, and I panicked. I called her and she explained that instead of doing our regular Lent devotional, she was asking some to share a little bit of their testimony. She asked if I would be willing to share, and I immediately told her that I was going to throw up. And she replied something along the lines of, "Great, throw up and then call me back and we'll talk about it." I clearly eventually agreed, and then she said, "Awesome, so you can be ready by this Sunday?" And I immediately said, "Nope, find someone else." She said, "Fine, your other option is Christmas Eve," and I thought to myself, well, that gives me 4 weeks to prepare, and that's great, and I agreed again. And then the next morning, my eyes popped open at 5 a.m., and the first thought in my brain was, there's two Sundays that people will go to church, and it's Easter and Christmas, and I panicked again. Because I don't like talking in front of people, and yet here we are. When I was 18, I found out that I was pregnant with Eli. You all can imagine how that went whenever I found out. There was panic, shame, and even some regret, but I immediately started praying for a healthy baby. The first person I told was my sister. She was nothing but supportive from the very beginning. She went with me to my appointment at the Hope Clinic the next day and held my hand through my first ultrasound before anyone else even knew that I was pregnant. They had asked me that day if I knew the options that I had and what I was going to do and how my parents would react and if I had any support. I knew then that I was going to have a baby, but I also knew how my parents were going to react and that was not going to go very well. I went home and called my mom and told her that I needed her to come home because I needed to tell her something. I prayed from the second that we ended the call until she pulled into the driveway. She walked in and I told her that I was going to have a baby, and that went about as well as you'd imagine. My dad was working nights and she made me wake him up before he went to work to tell him. That also was not very good timing. His response was, "Well, it sounds like we're going to have a baby, and what do we do next?" And that was that. My mom immediately made me start calling friends and family, aunts, uncles, grandparents, because it's Marshall County and word travels fast. One of the first people that she made me call was Johnny and Gail. It was one of the hardest conversations that I've ever had because they were huge Christian role models in my life. Their response was, "All babies are a blessing and this is going to be great." And in that moment, all I felt was peace and love. That all took place on a Wednesday. Saturday night, my parents looked at me and said, "You're going to church tomorrow morning." I was terrified, but I prayed for strength and courage, and I got up Sunday morning and came to church. Eli and Owen Anderson met me at the front door and said, "There's a baby in your belly." And I don't think I came to terms with the fact that I was actually pregnant until that moment. After church, there were tons of people that came up to me telling me how excited they were for me, how babies are a blessing and everything always works out. At that time, I felt hope and peace and love. Fast forward a little bit, I was getting close to finishing my bachelor's, and I had a 2-year-old that I was taking care of, and I had to get an internship. Most are 40 hours a week and typically non-paid. I prayed and prayed for something that would work out in my favor, and I was a nervous wreck because how was I supposed to parent my child alone, making no money unless I pick up another job on top of my internship, and then feel guilty about not spending enough time with Eli? Jan Riley reached out to me about a possible opportunity at Head Start, and I spoke with my advisor at school and applied for and interviewed for the job and was hired. I would get paid to complete my internship for school, finish my bachelor's degree, and work in an environment that I ended up loving. At that time, I felt nothing but peace. Through all of this, Eli and I were still living with my parents. I will forever be grateful for their guidance, support, and allowing Eli and I to stay there, but I knew for myself and my child that it was time for us to take the step to be on our own. I prayed for a son that for what would be the next best move for us. My grandparents graciously offered their pole barn apartment for us to live in while I was saving up money to work for us to buy our own home eventually. That offered me so much peace, and I knew it was only out of love for Eli and I. A year or so later, my aunt called my dad and said that she had come across a home that would be a great opportunity to purchase, flip, and rent out because they do rentals. I had mentioned previously possibly being ready to buy a home for Eli and I to them, so they agreed to go with me to look at the home. I prayed and prayed that it would be a good fit for us. It needed some work, but as you guys know, my dad's kind of a handyman and can do pretty much anything. But when I saw it, I knew that Eli and I could make it a home. At that time, I felt joy, peace, and love. All of this to say, through these times, there have been lots of loss along the way. There have been bad times and times that I blamed God for the wrongs in my life and I ran as fast as I could away from Him. I'm a sinner who needs grace. But I think one of the most important things to remember is that even though things don't go the way that we believe they're supposed to, or our timelines get thrown out of whack, or we're not always in control, there's always a bigger plan or blessing to come. We have to persevere and be persistent in prayer and patient in trusting that God is using us exactly how He's intended and that things will always work out. Philippians chapter 4 reads, "Rejoice in the Lord always. I will say it again, rejoice. Let your gentleness be evident to all. The Lord is near. Do not be anxious about anything, but in every situation, by prayer and petition with thanksgiving, present your requests to God, and the peace of God, which transcends all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Jesus Christ." God loves us despite all of our wrongdoings or mistakes, and only through Him will we truly have hope, peace, joy, and love. Please pray with me. God, thank you for all of the blessings throughout this Advent season. We know that you're the source of all of the good things that are coming to us. We praise you for your love and patience and the ultimate gift that you gave us through Jesus Christ. Help us to recognize your presence the remainder of this season, and find our joy only through you. In Jesus' name, amen.
When we think about blessings, the world tells us that to be blessed, usually the world says we relate it to some kind of privilege, some kind of gain that we have, some kind of success, you know, hashtag blessed. But today in our scripture this morning, I think Jesus challenges that definition of what it means to be blessed. See, today in our scripture, I think we see one of the most joyous occasions in the entire scripture. One of the most joyous celebration. And get this, it's between an unwed pregnant teenager and I've debated on how to say this, but there's no other way to say it, and an old woman who's pregnant. They are full of indescribable joy. And get this, they both have a reason to celebrate, but they also had reasons to get together and cry. You see, for Mary, we hear every year, for her to be pregnant meant that she could be stoned. It was dangerous, her pregnancy. And where Mary grew up was just like Marshall County. Everybody knows real quick. But what about Elizabeth? Well, Elizabeth had lived her entire life barren. Elizabeth had lived her entire life being told that she was a sinner. That's why she couldn't have kids. Because that was people's beliefs back then. And then she gets pregnant. And we know people. So you know they had to be talking about her as well. But all the world was going on around them. And yet, in the midst, they find joy. And here they are rejoicing. And what they're rejoicing in has nothing to do with what they've done. They have done one thing, and this is the only thing they have done in this scripture that they can rejoice in. The thing that they have done that they can rejoice in is they have said yes to God. That is it. Their joy is in their yes. The rest of that joy, I would say 1% of that joy is their yes. Or in Mary's case, let it be unto me as you have said. The rest of their joy, 99% of their joy comes from what God is doing. What God has done, what God is doing, what God is going to do. And this morning, we are asked, is that where your joy is? Or is your joy right now dependent upon your circumstance? What's going on in your life? Is your joy dependent on what's under the tree tomorrow? I sure hope not. Is your joy right now dependent on your feelings? I sure hope not. You see, for Mary, her joy is depending on what God's going to do. And if you look in the chapter over in Luke chapter 2, you'll see another prophecy about Jesus come from Simon. And it says he'll be the rise and fall of many people in Israel. But here's the one for Mary. A sword will pierce your own soul too. So this joy in what God's doing isn't necessarily easy. So this morning, I want to challenge us. When we say we are blessed, we think of it as our blessings as a cross-shaped blessing. What if our blessings come in the form of a cross? What if our blessings, our joy comes, as Mary says, from surrendering all? The greatest joy you'll ever have in your life is to say yes to Jesus. Doesn't mean an easy life. Notice I didn't say that. Doesn't mean easy. Doesn't mean a bubble. Doesn't mean free of shame, guilt, or mistakes. Absolutely not. But it means joy. Doesn't mean happiness. It means deeper joy. And it comes from yes to Jesus, from surrendering all. It comes, that greatest joy comes from being a servant of Jesus. Being able to say today, in your heart, as much as faith as you can muster, let it be God unto me as you have said. That is joy. Over and over in Scripture, we see the word blessed. There's two Greek words that are translated blessed. One, we get the word eulogy from. It means to praise and talk good about somebody. And this is what Mary is saying. Mary is saying in her Scripture today when she says, "All everybody will call me blessed from now on." She is saying they'll all talk good about me. They'll all say, look what God has done in her life. Remember, folks, right here in this moment, she doesn't know what God's going to do with Joseph. She has no clue. She is trusting that God's going to take care of that detail. She is assuming here that she's going to have a full life and people are going to talk good about her. While right now they may be whispering and talking bad. Think about Mary in Marshall County. So even though they may say now, she knows because God's working, God's doing it. As she surrender, that they're going to talk good. That word eulogy is going to be praise and talk wonderful of the acts. The second word Greek used for, that's translated blessed, is basically means God's hand extended, God's hand enlarged. It's the work of grace. And you see that in like Jesus in the Beatitudes, that the word blessed there is different than this morning because it means basically in the Beatitudes, Jesus is saying God's grace is on the poor in the spirit. When you experience God's grace, when God's grace is extended to you, you absolutely become poor in spirit because you know you can't be dependent on anything else. And that is the kingdom of God. But we look at other places in Scripture where it talks about blessing and blessed. And we get things like this. We have been blessed under heaven in Ephesians 1:3, I think. Blessed with every spiritual blessing under heaven. Then we get on, blessed are you when you persevere during trials. Do we get this? Do we get what Scripture is saying? And Jesus tells, someone comes up to Jesus and says, blessed is basically the mother who bore you. And Jesus said, you are more blessed when you listen to my words and put them into action. Joy, if you want true joy, it comes from Jesus. It comes in the shape of a cross. Our blessings are in follower of Jesus. Is in the shape of a cross. It comes from God, allowing God to work in your life for His glory, not yours, for His kingdom, not yours, and trusting that God can take every piece that you give Him and use it for His glory and for His kingdom. What joy, is there any joy in knowing that God can take every broken piece and make it work for His kingdom? That's an amen. Amen. Yes. Isaiah 55, starting in verse 8. God says, my ways are not your ways. My ways are higher than your ways, so are my plans higher than your plans. And thank God that He's not like us. Yeah, whoever said amen that time, yes. Because what happens is He can take the broken pieces and use it for His good. So teenagers, and maybe adults too, but I'm going to talk to our teenagers for a second. Many of you are on that cusp or coming close to where you feel the pressure that you've got to plan the rest of your life. Probably talking to all of us. I mean, all of us here is probably thinking, what am I going to do the rest of my life? Even if you're 80 years old, you still don't get a free pass from being part of God's kingdom and working for God's kingdom. But you're thinking, oh my gosh, I've got to figure out what I'm going to do with the rest of my life. This moment, it hangs on everything. And yeah, I hear that preacher, trust God, trust God. I hear that youth preacher, trust God, trust God. Just give it to God. And I'm so sick of hearing it. So here's the good news that goes along with trust God this morning. The good news is, yes, you trust God. You put it in God's hands. You pray, you seek, you listen to what you think God is calling you to do. You go after it. But if you get in the middle of it and you realize, maybe I missed a preposition and God was adding a conjunction there. Maybe I thought this was for, and he said and. And you know what? You do the same thing. You trust God. Because this God is big enough. And in his hands, you may think, well, I've just wasted 2 years doing this. No, 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 you haven't. Because nothing is wasted in the hands of God. Nothing. Adults here, you may be thinking, well, my life, I've just wasted. Nothing's wasted in the hands of God. Yeah, at this very moment, if you are 99 and you think, I've wasted, put your hand in the life, put your hand in God's hand, because even at 99, it's not wasted. Abraham became a father at 100, just throwing that out there. You see, when we go for it, when we go and we try to follow Jesus, even if we don't hear correctly or we get confused along the way, one, Jesus is there, and because of the joy, he forgives us. But two, we can trust him to open that other path. We can trust him to take this season of our life and use it for the next season. And for the next season, for you and I, we don't have to have anything figured out. That doesn't mean we're sitting around twiddling our thumbs. You see, Mary didn't have it figured out. She knew she was pregnant. She knew God had made some pretty cool promises to her through this pregnancy. And she didn't know how Joseph was going to react, how God was going to take care of it. But she had joy, even in the midst, because she knew God was working. Youth, children, young adults, middle-aged adults, retirees, God is working. He is working. The question is, have we surrendered? And a side note, scripture also says to much who've been given, much is required. So let's talk about the so many blessings we have in this church. Look around. I'm going to go out on a limb here and say there's not a person in here who God hasn't given. Every good and great thing comes from God above. To much who's been given, what talents are in here? There's a lot of talents in here. To much who've been given, much is required. We come celebrating that God moved the universe to bring his son, to take on skin, to take on our sins, to take on our death, so that we can have life. Do you get this? God moved the universe. God overruled the laws of physics. And there's a lot of you who are gifted in physics in here, and that's all I'm going to say about that. But God moved the universe to save you and I, to bring about his kingdom. And I want us to think a minute. Is it easier for God to move the universe than to move you and I for the kingdom of God? Does God find it easier to get the universe to submit to his will than you? I'm going to leave it there. And me. You sitting there and me standing here to work for his kingdom of God. Because that's where the joy is. You can search for joy all the rest of your days. You can try to find it in a car, in things, in material things. It'll never be enough. You can try to find joy by being happy all the time. Happiness is fleeting. It's a feeling that comes and goes. Or you can find the true joy that is in Jesus Christ. Amen. Woo! So this morning, I invite you to ask, where is your joy? Is it like Mary? Are you sitting there singing your deepest joy is what Jesus is doing in your heart? Of what he's doing in your life? How he's going to use you? Because you've submitted all your time, your talent, and you say, God, the universe is not going to be easier to move than me for your kingdom. Move me, God. Are you searching for your joy somewhere else? The hope, the love, the joy, peace came in the form of a baby born in a manger tonight. Let us pray. Gracious, loving God, Lord, I pray for anybody here who has not surrendered all to you, Jesus, that they find their joy in you. It's not a false joy. It's not temporary. It's a joy that knows that you are God and that you are with us and that we always have love, joy, peace, and hope. And it's through you, Jesus. God, this Christmas, the greatest gift we could receive if we have not received is you. Is your Son, Jesus Christ, who is knocking on the hearts, every one of our hearts. Behold, and let's get that word. Behold, I stand at the door and knock. And if you feel him knocking right now, I pray that you let him in. That you don't care what anybody around you is going to think. That you can't care what your neighbor's going to think. You're not going to care even what your family is going to think. That you say, Jesus, I am tired. I am tired of living with synthetic joy. I want the true joy that came down from heaven. That joy that I can put my entire hope and trust in my entire life. That can take every broken piece, every bad decision, every wrong, every mistake, everywhere part where, God, I thought I heard you, but I didn't hear you quite right. Who can take that, Jesus? Who can take that sin, that shame that I've been living with, that took it upon that cross? God, I want to know a cross-shaped blessing in my life. I want the cross, because after the cross comes resurrection. So gracious God, don't let any heart leave without that joy. And it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Would you please stand and join us now as we sing, Oh Come, All Ye
joyful.
26, it's close by. Forgot the name of the road, but Bill Carr's here if you want to help. Now go forth, and may the love of God and the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit lead, guide, and direct us as we go forth and shine our light. Take the love of God with you. Amen.